than they had been. Right now, you probably know this, unemployment 9.6%. The Fed thinks that's only going to drop slightly to 9% by the end of next year, maybe to 8% by the time the presidential election hits in 2012. Now, you've got that prediction on one hand. That means at least 10 million Americans will remain jobless for the next 2 years. But companies made more money in the third quarter than ever before in history. Profits soaring to almost $1.7 trillion a year when you average all that together. Let's bring in our company. Boris Epstein, Galena Espinoza, and Alicia Menendez. Good to see all
good
of you. There's got to be, when you look at that disconnect, Alicia, a political argument in there somewhere. When you see that the unemployment rate is going to remain at least 10 million people through 2012, but record high profits for corporations.
There's an argument and there's a challenge, which is the Obama administration needs to do two things simultaneously. They need to deal with economic growth in real time at the moment for people who are jobless. But as the Fed report showed us, they also need to be able to tackle these larger structural challenges. Right now, we have a workforce that is completely out of whack with our work needs. And so what that means is we need to innovate. We need to have regional innovation. And we need to begin retraining our workers so that they have the skills they need in order to gain employment in the United States.
You know, one of the headlines I saw that really struck me, they talked about how these profits, Boris, are linked to rising productivity. And what they said is that corporate profits are coming out of workers' hides. Is that fair?
I don't think it's fair. Here's what's happening. Partly the reason for the number is not that the companies are making more, it's they're writing off less. They've already written off some of the bad investments that were made during the crisis and before the crisis. So that write-off is done. What you're seeing is that jobs are a lagging indicator. What that means is that unemployment rises later on when the economy is going down and the unemployment goes down.
I'm getting a little lost in these crazy economic arguments.
The bottom line is this. The companies are not spending on employment because they're not convinced the economy is as far ahead as it should be.
And yet they've had, I mean, isn't it a little harder to make that argument when you have record high profits, but the highest quarter in history?
But they have not made more money than before. That number is too simplistic. They didn't make more money. They wrote off less. So, and what's happening is that they're only spending 7% on new employment.
I think
they're
that sounds like semantics
less.
To the American
it
worker.
It is small consolation to the average
American out there. It's not supposed to be consolation. What I'm saying is that what we're seeing more profits now. Should businesses start hiring again? Absolutely. I'm not telling them they shouldn't. I'm saying they should 100%. I'm just explaining why it hasn't happened up to now. But I agree, and I think we all agree, that it's incumbent upon businesses to start hiring more, and therefore we should tax them less.
Bottom line, too, Galena, if the economy isn't going to get better, and a lot of people have said in their analysis, political analysts, that 8% is sort of that magic number for the president. If we're not looking at that till the end of 2012 does not bode well for the president.
No, and especially at a time when Congress could not extend long-term unemployment benefits. You know, they just last week voted on that. They couldn't get that extended. There's very little being offered to help the average American. And so I do think that whether or not, whatever the reasoning behind it is, I think that the Americans need to see some sort of improvement happening.
Absolutely.
And right now there's very little that's coming down that's reassuring.
Absolutely.
Does it give any more impetus, I think, Alicia, to the argument that you can extend middle-class tax cuts but not higher income tax cuts?
I actually do think this falls squarely in that. And Galena raises an excellent point with the unemployment benefits, which is that was a very partisan vote. In as much as this is about the Obama administration, this is about what Republicans are going to do now that they have more power than they've had in the last 4 years. I mean, that said, Chris, I do think that comes back to this issue of taxes. People get confused. We're giving 100% of people the tax cut they already had. The question is, do we want to give the top 1% an additional tax cut, and I think the majority of us agree that at this time that is not the best way.
The majority of us don't agree. That's why the majority voted Republicans into the House.
So I don't think that's why the Republicans were as successful as they were this time around. I completely disagree with that.
What's really happening is that if we do away with the tax cuts, then the small businesses who make above $250 but are taxed at a personal rate will hire less, and that'll be bad for the economy.
All right, that's the argument the Republicans have made. We'll see how it all plays out. Boris, Galena, Alicia, thank you. They'll all be back. And in the meantime, we're keeping our eye on what's going on in the streets of London. Students protesting higher tuition fees. It would actually be about a tripling of fees. We saw it a couple of weeks ago, yesterday, now again today. They've been mostly peaceful, although there have been some incidents. We know of a few police officers who have gotten hurt, some windows that have been broken. We'll keep our eye on it here on Jansing & Company.
Time for the Your Business Entrepreneur of the Week.
North Carolina natives Jenny Fulton and Ashley Furr worked in the financial industry.